Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG Chick. We are now about to enter the old slave block. In we go.
I'm going.
Now I'm not sure if this means the slave block is old, or there are old slaves in that slave block. Oh, we go down. We can't get down there? Right, we've got some loot here.
Fine.
22 shins and a concentrated spray flash. I always have trouble saying that. I love those things though. It's like candy. So I have a regular spray flash there. Concentrated there. Concentrated there. I guess I'll give another to Calistee. She just has one. She has one regular, I think. Yeah. This way everyone can heal when we need it. Cool. This wheeled vehicle looks like it was abandoned here during some kind of military assault. Can we not go down here? Ah! It opens up. Oh, there's where these Murdens are. Oh, this sounds so much like the main theme of Planescape Torment. I heard a little of that. It's like the same instrument and everything. We got Murdens. Now, we had a chance to come across them earlier in the game, much earlier. But I think we went late. And some mercenaries killed them first. So we may or may not end up into a fight with them here. Codex entry unlocked. Murdens. Two hunched avian humanoids stare at you, their bright and hate-filled eyes shining above dirty yellow beaks. You recognize them at once. Murdens. They emit a kind of psychic fuzz, a mental blanket that makes it difficult for you to concentrate. One puffs up its greasy black feathers to make itself look larger, while the other scrapes close to the ground. Their arms wave and gesture, and the intent is clear. Go no further. Ooh, I took 3 damage. Your ability to read minds only exacerbates the static, amplifying it to painful levels. It takes a supreme effort of will to shut out the noise. Apparently reading the minds of Murdens is a bad idea. I didn't actually try to do it. I guess it's an automatic thing. It is an automatic thing. Intimidate. I'm not too good at that. Persuasion. I'm good at. And we have the intelligence for it. I mean you no harm. I've come to retrieve the standard for our Tagliato's irregulars. We're looking for the frame also for, what's his name? Allegern. 80%. Nice. Success. One of them points its blade towards the adjoining room. They back slowly and nervously away, keeping their eyes on you the whole time. Sweet. Alright, let's check out this codex entry. See what we can find out about Murden's creatures. These bird-like abhumans are covered in greasy black feathers, their faces surmounted by sharp yellow beaks and beady eyes. They wear tattered leather cloaks and carry bulging leather bags to hoard the treasures they compulsively collect. So like, yeah, huge crows or something. This makeshift bed consists of rags, dirty feathers, and assorted junk. Same. And same. Can... What if I... Pressing my luck, I know, trying to talk to one of them. The Murden draws back from you, hissing, and it looks nervously to its comrade on the other side of the room, and emits a burst of mental static that feels like trepidation. You don't want to talk to me, do you? Again, the creature glances at the other Murden, hisses at you, and waves its arms to shoo you away. Sk, or hick, sss. How about this guy? Same? You gonna look at your friend, too? The Murden puffs itself up, its greasy black down expanding as its beady eyes size you up. You note that this creature is slightly larger than its comrade. It croaks a harsh and glottal challenge, and a burst of mistrustful static fuzzes your thoughts. Where is your leader? Take me to your leader. The Murden ducks its head, bobbing from side to side to keep you in view, and it points its wicked blade toward the adjoining room. Well, which way is that? There's two adjoining rooms. I guess it means this room? Oh, it is. There's a lot more of those in there.
Happy to help.
Let's go in here. There's some loot. Hopefully they don't see us taking it. An attack. Worth it. Two concentrated spray flesh and as well 38 shins. Attacking. That's a good thing. Let's just do this. Alright, what is this again? Hastened and movement speed. Okay. Well, this is... goes here. Or does it? I have the shadow ring now. I'm just checking this out. That's gotta be helping me. And the spirit shroud. That's very helpful, actually. Yeah, I'm gonna keep it as is, then. I'm not gonna mess with these doors yet. There's another room over there as well. I must see it, but first we'll go in here. Hail, Murdens! Murden Chief. Same. Junk, mattress, rags, and stuff. The translator. Oh, it's a person, the translator. See if these guys say anything. Ch-ch-ch. X. Be quite a fight if we think we piss them off. What's that? Skeleton or something. Yeah, same. I know it's probably better to go through this translator, but I want to see what happens. Okay, she's automatically going to translate. The larger size of this Murden and the gray down that tinges his beak and eyes gives him a more stately and menacing look than his compatriots. His clothes are less tattered, and he projects an aura of command. As you approach, he hisses at the other Murdens, and the annoying mental static dies down considerably, leaving only his singular field as a sharper source. The noise whines and scratches in your head, and as the chief speaks, the human woman at his side speaks in a dull monotone. A squalling blast of static, and then she says, "No. Pretty cloth from drinking man belong here. Right of theft. If drinking man want it, he steal it back." Let me ask about something else instead. I'll come back to this. Ask what? Tell me about your people. I feel like I'm playing Starflight. The young woman waits for a moment while the chief and his underlings hiss and click back and forth to each other. What to say? We are Murdens. We hunt, we find, we take. Humans hate us. In world outside, we flee from them. Here, we rule. Her shoulders roll, an obscene imitation of an avian shrug. Here, humans fear us. We are Murdens. We take what we want. Humans not tell us what to do. Not here in Bloom. What is that static in the air? Upon hearing your question, all the Murdens in the room begin cackling and shrieking. Ha, 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 says the translator in a monotone voice, barely audible over the noise. When the Murdens have settled down, the harsh static of the chief fills your head, and then the translator speaks. That is our thoughts. That is how we speak. No need for clumsy words like you, stupid human. Oh, nice. Who is this woman who speaks your words? The woman stands impassively as the Murdens buzz static through several irritating frequencies back and forth. At last, the chief's mental buzz cuts through them all. She recites the words without feeling or awareness. This is not woman. Shell is empty. Woman is gone. Why you speak of it as human? It is machine. When it expires, we find new machine. We not speak human language. We buy slave. We fix slave's brain. Slave becomes machine. Machine speak human. She pauses while the chief clacks and hisses. Slave not need whole brain anymore. Excess brain was tasty. Nice. Ate part of her frickin' brain. Basically, yeah. Wouldn't call them cannibals because we're not their kind. But yeah. Basically, yeah. Nasty, still. Have you seen any of the Memovera's patrols lately? The guards? They not come here. They learn. The Murdens in the room shift on their feet and hiss. In quick succession and in varying pitches, she adds, "Ha, ha, 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 ha." I have to try different pitches. I'm looking for a black metal frame that you recently took from the humans. The chief squawks, and a translator speaks, "Ha, ha, we have many treasures. Not remember frame." Huh. "I am here for the return of our Taglio standard, the flag in your nest." Why do we want it exactly? We killed them. And they go tied. A squalling blast of static, and then she says, "No, pretty cloth from drinking man belong here. Right of theft. If drinking man want it, he steal it back." Now, because I went out of it and back in, I got indigo tied, small amount. Alright, I gotta try persuasion. Or deception, whatever comes up. "If you return it, you'll gain much. Respect. Possibly the friendship of Ortaglio. More freedom to roam the bloom." Never mind, he's freaking... I don't know if he's dead. You know what? The moss spits him back out in a different place, he might still be alive. Only he won't remember where he is, or have no eyes, or whoever... Who the hell knows what that, it wanted. It wanted his bravery or something. But maybe he'll come back as a coward. Anyway. Give it a try. 50%? That's it? Damn it! The Murden Chief hisses angrily, and a burst of mental static follows. "No, human. If drinking man want cloth, he can put drink down and come. He can take it back. If he steal it, it is his. If he not, it is ours. No trade." Another burst of static. "Maybe I need new speaking human shell. Drinking man not use brain anyway. Wonder if his brain tastes like his poison drink." The gathered Murdens hiss in approval. "Yes. Eat drinking man brain. Ha. Show humans who rule here. Yes. Go. Gotta try something. Alright. It's not this. That's an ornament. Yes. Plus one training level in that skill while active. So I have... I don't know, do we need both? It was persuasion and deception. Deception, I have complete inability. Well, no wonder. I guess... I guess persuasion, I'm just... Huh. See, Tiber is really good with persuasion and deception. And I thought I saw someone switch, you know, to another character and use their abilities. But I haven't figured out how to do it in this. And maybe that was on a console? I don't even know. If I speak right to the translator, is there a difference? Preservation of beauty. Oh! It wants this one. The, decanted. This slim, fit young woman would be attractive if it weren't for the blank stare in her eyes, the spit drooling from her mouth, and the poorly implanted devices that protrude from her skull. The area around the implants weeps pus and some strange, clear fluid. It does not appear that she has been mistreated in any other way. No bruises or scars mark her otherwise smooth flesh. No, they just ate part of her brain. It's, you know, not enough. Unsurprisingly, you read no thoughts of any kind from her. What's your name? She stares blankly. You can see the slight pulse of her heartbeat in the veins near one metallic nodule on her forehead, and she breathes, but lacking these signs, only the thin stream of drool gathering mass at her chin tells you that she lives. Her gaze is completely empty. She doesn't respond at all. Kellestes looks at the young woman with disgust and mutters, "Such a poor job. Whoever installed these devices should be flogged and eaten by Vorn worms." She catches you looking at her and she gestures. If you remove those implants, you'd be left with an empty shell, a rapidly dying one at that. They sustain her and keep her technically alive, but her higher brain functions have been erased. A skilled practitioner. Bah. No matter. The young woman begins to bark and choke a little, bending at the waist as she spits out a guttural string of hard consonants. A moment later, you realize that she was merely imitating the Murden Chief, who's been watching your interactions with the woman. Yeah, I can't figure we went unnoticed. The Murden is struggling not to laugh out loud. So are the rest of the Murdens. Their mental static is filled with savage glee at seeing the human make a fool of herself. The Murden Chief's voice comes through the woman's mouth. Do you speak to empty bags? To corpses? Do they answer? Empty husks not speak. Those wanting answers want to speak to me. The woman continues to stare blankly ahead. Okay, fine. So we have another person for this. Preservation of beauty, which I'm surprised these... You know, get these little exclamation marks anymore. The Murdens in the old slave block have lobotomized an attractive young woman to serve as a translator of sorts. While her fate is lamentable, she may be of interest to the Decanted. I can't see it would get any worse for her. Seriously. She's not even going to be aware of anything that happens.
Yes, lass.
So out of anyone... Oh, Tyvir? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to talk to you. Out of any of them, I feel the least bad about her. I don't feel bad about her at all. Why you come here, human? You're kind. Too afraid. They see their fate. The girl gestures to herself, mimicking the movements of the Murden Chief. I'm not completely sure if it takes from persuasion or deception or like whatever's the best of the two, or if I need both. But let's try then. Do I already have... No. Did I use this already? Wait, I think I have to go out here.
Here. Now.
So aggressive with that. Here we go. Let's try persuasion. Ha!
Just what I needed.
Alright, hopefully this will be enough. Let me ask again. Return the standard and you'll reap goodwill among the humans of the Bloom. Oh, I can switch here. I didn't know I could do that. Use Tyvir. Yeah, I wasted that. I could get 100% with Tyvir. Good God, I've been playing not knowing this all this time. Success. You want cloth? Replace it. But not with coin. Not with things. Replace it with experience. Her monotone breaks slightly here, the emphasis of the Murden's thought pushing more strongly on her. Flight. I want to hunt in the sky. Give me experience of hunting flight and dive on prey. Then I return cloth to drinking man. How the hell would I do that? Give me the experience of hunting flight and diving on prey. As the other Murdens hiss and clack, she adds, ha. Chief funny. Haha. Impossible. Is that... Wait. Is that something we could actually achieve? It's not even in here. Alright, who's good at intimidation then? I could switch. It's probably gonna be Aretas. No, huh? No one's good at intimidation, huh? I don't have inability in it. Well, I do want to try that, though. Well, what is this thing?
Of course.
Oh, the standard is right there. A battered standard lines the edge of the Murden Chief's nest, covered in his filth. Its cloth is torn and ragged, but it remains largely intact. Perception check reveals, as you look more closely, you see it depicts a silver stein on a field azure with a bar of three downward-facing triangles atop and below, just like the flag hanging outside the door of his tent. This is most definitely Ortaglio's standard. Alright. Well, I could either just take it and I'll attack. Is it theft if I take it from your bloody corpse? Give it to me. Now. I can go up to 85. That worked! Nice! The Murden Chief shrinks from your words. The Murdens around him grow silent and still as they watch their leader fetch the filthy standard from his nest. He passes it to you wordlessly, and hardly a trace of the psychic noise around him leaks out as he does so. Well, they don't need it, they're all dead, but maybe we can sell it or something. Quest item, though. No, I guess not. This battle standard is torn and ragged. It depicts a silver stein on an azure field, with a bar of three downward-facing triangles above and below. All right. It's a quest item, but we killed them. It doesn't have to do with missing patrols. Well, we got it. Oh, what the hell we do with it now? I have no idea. Probably nothing.
Why not?
Alright, let's see if we can get this other thing, which is probably in here somewhere. Oh, there's another area.
All right.
Crumbling masonry serves as a testament to a past effort to reinforce the walls, but the bloom seems to have other ideas.
Sure enough.
Before we open any doors, I'm just gonna look around. Oh, we go down. All right. Well, let's open this door then.
Let's go.
This old metal door looks fairly solid. It has a single mechanical lock. You notice that the mechanism appears complicated, suggesting that it's more than just a simple lock. Let's examine the lock more closely. Embedded within the locking mechanism is a thin bladder of air, and as you look more carefully, you realize that the bladder is somehow connected to a series of tubes. This is a trap. A cunning, ingenious trap that is beyond the skill of the Murdens. It must be part of the original design of the door. Huh. Try to disarm the trap, I guess, yeah. Best thing other than picking the lock. 85% chance. Success! Ooh! Moving slowly and methodically, you trace the trigger mechanisms to a pinhole nozzle in the front of the door, which leads back to a small reservoir. It contains a dangerous substance that would be sprayed on a hapless victim. After disabling the triggers, you remove the reservoir from the door. You are now the proud owner of a small sack of molecular acid. So proud. Crack! creates an immediate size slick of noxious acid, dealing 13 chemical damage to any character who enters or starts their turn in the area. This small sack of acid was part of a cunning trap that you removed from a door in the old slave block. Its membrane is thin and easily punctured. If you throw it at an enemy, it will splatter them with molecular acid and probably create a hazardous pool on the ground. Cool. That's a cipher. Let's have Eritus smash the door in now that we... He's good at that kind of thing. Now that we disarmed it, you hurl yourself at the door. The lock breaks and the door swings open. Cool. Alright, so we got negative fennel here. We should start using some of these. Actually, I have no one to give it to. So I'll probably throw it at somebody in the next battle, whenever that is. Oh, we have thugs who are injured. They've been in here for how long? Strips of flesh have been torn from this corpse, and the eye sockets are empty. Judging by the armor, this was one of the Memovira's thugs. Oh, this is where the missing people are. Skinned creatures hang from wooden poles, dripping blood on the ground. This room must serve as the Murden's larder. Oh, I thought they couldn't use it because... the lock was not made by them or something.
Making a note.
Two men share this cell. Both of them wear the armor of the Memovira's soldiers. A third soldier lies on the ground nearby, lifeless. One of the survivors is badly hurt, bleeding and clutching his side. The other, a younger man, appears uninjured. His hands are bound with rusty manacles, and he looks blearily up at you with eyes that suggest that he's waiting for the butcher's blade. When he realizes that you're not a Murden, his face lights with frantic hope. Oh, thank the gods you've come. If you could free us, you can name your reward with Briska, or with the Memovira herself. How'd you get here? We've been on this route for a long time. A very long time. We've never had any trouble with the Murdens before. They've always paid their tribute, so we had no reason to think they'd just try to slaughter us. We fought back, and we survived the fight, but... He gestures to his companion. I don't know how much longer he'll survive. We need your help to escape. He thinks Zabak's got a family back in Sagus. I've got to try to get him out of here. It was the normal collection route. We never thought. His wounded companion groans softly, and the younger man puts out a hand to steady him. Hang in there, Zabak. How have you been treated? They give us some bowls of slop now and then, but I don't dare eat it. If I used it as a chamber pot, you'd never know the difference. Otherwise, they ignore Zabak and me. I mean, if you don't count the time when they came in here and ate pieces of Pell, they're keeping us fresh, is what I think, instead of letting us rot. Our turn will come, I'm sure of it. He thinks, I heard screaming down the hall. What are they keeping us fresh for? Free them. There's a key by the door, friend, he says. Just use that and... Excellent. He finishes as you unlock him and his friend. Can I trouble you for something else? With the shape Zabak is in, there's no way we can get out of here. Alive. At least not with the Murden guards watching the entryway. Can you do something about them? Wait here for now. We're gonna have to fight them. Just don't leave us here to die. This man's breathing is labored, and his eyes barely focus on you. Blood has soaked his brigandine armor. You're better off talking to him, he nods at his comrade. His voice is soft, almost a whisper. I ain't got much breath left in me. What happened to you? Double-crossed by the Murdens. We came to collect the boss lady's tribute, as we always do. They fell on us like the mud birds they are. He puts a hand to his side. Broke one of their beaks with my fist. Got me a couple stab wounds for my trouble. Good thing my kids can't see me now. Double-crossed. tried to collect our usual tribute, and the Murdens attacked us. They were always afraid of us before. Your name is Zebak? I think I met your children in Sega's Clefs. Zeb and Nim? Yep, from Cliff's Edge. He reaches out a shaking hand to clutch your shoulder. Are they well? Well, I wish I didn't have to just say it like this. You might want to sit down. I'm gonna say that, or that. I don't think he had a choice with this, and I'm not gonna lie. Or should I lie? No, I'm gonna be honest. Your daughter is dead. Your son stepped through a gateway to another time. Little Nim? She's gone. He shuts his eyes tight and buries his face in his hands. I killed her. By losing track of time, staying here too long. And for what? A few extra shins? He opens his eyes again. But Zeb... He's... coming back, isn't he? I couldn't say for sure. Gold tied. Of course he is. He grips your arm, and suddenly he's a hardened soldier again. Of course he is, and I have to follow him through this gateway. By the Black Three, I will. He breaks into a coughing fit, and his grip grows slack. I'm getting out of this place. I'm going home. I'm tracking down my son, and he ain't gonna stop till I find him. Not ever. Let me take a look at your wounds. Our natural lore tells us... Aye, he murmurs. Peeling back his blood-caked armor, he looks at you with a mix of hope and dread, probably assuming that you're a healer. Fortunately, you have some knowledge of medicine, or you remember some of your sire's knowledge, perhaps. The soldier's wounds don't smell of corruption, and you're certain they're survivable, but only with treatment, which he won't get until he escapes the cell. I think I can get you out of here. If you're gonna help us escape, better talk to him. He nods at his comrade. I won't be much use, but I'll follow along as best I can. Coughs. He nudges his companion, and both of them look at you with hope in their pain-filled eyes. Is the way clear? Did you get rid of the Murden guards at the entrance? Wait here for now. What's in these other doors?
On my way.
Before we go down, or before we go back to them.
All right.
Yes, child.
I want to see what's in these other rooms. Beneath the grate, a vertical shaft descends into darkness. Faint whispers echo from somewhere down below. Manacles hang from the ancient stone plinth, but they're rusted and useless. No one's been chained here in a long time. Ditto for that one. Got some loot. 32 shins, and an essence of a single sigh. The malachite-tinted bauble, filled with ashen vapor, pulsates at the touch. When peered at long enough, it invokes an intense feeling of solitude. The examiner never knows whether to embrace it or shun it. Interesting. There's nothing we can use. Little room.
All right.
Let's see what's here. There's a Skoura the Faceless inside there. A cleverly made bed lies at the back of this cell, cobbled together from scraps of wood and rope.
In this world, then.
This creature stirs and mutters at your approach. Though the form is recognizably humanoid, her head is horribly disfigured. Something has wiped her face clean of features, leaving an expanse of mottled and bulbous flesh, save only for a horrifically enlarged mouth and two small holes where her ears should be. She hears your approach. and clutches a small jar close to her chest. What would you have with Skoura? Though my looks have been stolen, scribbled away by a million thoughtless particles, I can hear you breathing. I can taste what others can only smell. Your fear, your exertion. She smacks her oversized lips. Tell me, if you had lost your sight, what price would you pay for its return? She thinks, a new taste, a strange one. Will this one help me? Only one way to know. Would they regrow? Huh. What price? Time only, I suppose. My eyes would regrow eventually.
Making a note.
Blue tired. Ah! I might have expected such an answer from someone with a strange taste like yours. I would welcome such a gift, but I can tell you... I can tell that you haven't experienced the privation of blindness. She nods toward her jar. This is a piece of the Iron Wind. It is my most prized possession. I would give it away in a moment, if it meant that I could see once again. What happened to you? I was a nano once, a researcher on the cutting edge of the science of, nano spirits. In particular, I sought to harness the power of the Iron Wind, but the shields, my shields, they gave way around me, and the Iron Wind swirled in and found me. She smiles sadly, her immense mouth drooling. She pats the jar. I captured some of the Iron Wind here, but it still remade me. I was cast out, an abomination. And now I skulk and beg for my living. At least the Murdens fear me. Eritus says, so the Iron Wind stole your face? Is it in that jar? If so, can I see? Perhaps I should hold on to that jar, especially if it steals faces. And he thinks, no, 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 but they will eat him alive. Yes, and they will eat us alive too. Yes, but you'd have to get Skoura's permission. Apparently he doesn't hear anything past the word yes, because he moves with amazing speed to take the jar from Skoura's hands. Oh, crap. Beg pardon, m'lady, but we can't have face-stealing jars sitting around and mocking their victims. We'll set this jar right. He gives the jar a solid shake. Is this sealed tightly? It seems a little loose. It sounds like sand is moving around inside. Is that the sound faces make when they're removed? It's a kind of whooshing noise. Don't open it, Eritus. Oh my god. He thinks... Stop him. We can't. What was the other option? I think he would have grabbed it no matter what. I don't remember the other option, but... What? Somehow, with idiot luck, he opens a lid. It fades in a haze of energy, and a wave of grayish-red particles spill out in a vortex of unimaginable power. They wash over you and through you, rewriting your genetics at the most atomic level, changing you forever. Changing me? Or Eritus? Scanning thoughts of zzzz. What the hell? Ha ha! There's a thing that endures. Twisted and knotted from cast-off flesh, the Iron Wind has made a puzzle from you. One that asks, who is the greater fool, Eritus for unleashing the wind, or you for letting him?